Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Exotic Astrology once again. And we are delighted to have Anuradha Sharda ji with us once again. And today she is going to enlighten us with one of the most secret and mysterious topics, which is retrograde planets. So welcome, madam. Please enlighten us about retrograde planets.
Hello, Bhavaji. Thank you for the welcome. Retrograde planets are beautiful planets. And why do I say that? Retrograde planets are beautiful planets because when you're doing the shut bulb, you will also see one of the bulb that, or one of the strengths that is given to the retrograde planets, and it is known as Cheshta bulb. Now, what is Cheshta? Cheshta means your ability to try, you keep on trying. So this particular phase of a planet gives us an ability to try. Now, when you have any, when you see when you read a chart, you will always see the retrograde planets in brackets most of the time in most of the charts. So these are the limitations, okay? And on both the sides, it just has a significance. That is how I learned to remember it. And I have to, the planet has to move out of these limitations on either side of it. This is one way of remembering it. Now, what is the limitation and why does it have to try too hard to come out of it? So let's go there also. And why is a planet, retrograde planet, so important for us? Why is it that? So let's see all of it. Okay. So this is just one function that I'm taking up. Retrograde planets is a study in itself. Different houses, placement in different houses, ownership of different houses will give you various results. But today I'm taking up a very basic cause of retrograde planet. Okay. So retrograde planet and the functions. When we're talking like that, we need to know that when all the seven planets in a chart are direct, okay, you will come across very few charts, you know, in your normal reading. You also do a lot of readings, Bhavaji. So you will see that at least one or two of planets are retrograde. At least one planet is retrograde in most of the charts you will see. Very rarely will you come across a chart where all the planets are direct. That's a new energy. That person has started with a very comparatively new energy from past life, where he's finished a lot of his actions and not bought some overdue from past life. That is how it is measured most of the time. And where all the seven planets are retrograde, it's a very, very rare phenomenon, extremely rare phenomenon. So most of us are in this zone of one or more retrograde planets. That's the most common zone that we reside on. Okay. So, how you will have to, this is just a presentation where you will understand the energy of a retrograde planet and why is it very strong. So, as children, have you ever traveled in a train, Bhavaji, in India? Huh?
Yes.
So were there instances when, you know, the second there was always a train coming from behind and over crossing and moving ahead? Or we would be sitting in a train and that train would be crossing the other train. And at that point, we felt that one of the trains was going backwards. It was either us or them. But none of us were going backwards. There was only a difference in the relative speed. So in effect, in retrograde, none of the planets are going backwards. It is because of their difference in the relative speed, okay, that this effect can be seen. One. Two, it is also because when we are talking specifically about outer planets or inferior planets like Mars, Jupiter and Saturn, which are beyond the boundary of Earth. Because what happens is these planets, I'm not talking about the inner planets of your Mercury and Venus, because they're always very close to the Sun. And in fact, they go ahead of the sun. They be at a certain degree, at a certain angle, and then because they cannot go ahead of the sun after a certain degree, they will always retrograde back. They will always retrograde. So I'm not talking about them. They are very close to the sun. But sun is our center of the universe, of our universe at least, as I say. And because we all revolve, the entire solar system revolves around our sun. So there is a distance. You will see the retrograde planets, be it Mars, Jupiter, or Saturn, they will always be retrograding when they are farthest away from the sun. Okay, so when the sun comes in their from them, when the sun is in the ninth house, so I'll show you that. Say sun is in the fifth house from a planet. Say Jupiter is stationed in Scorpio. So when sun is in Pisces, Jupiter will start retrograding, and it will keep retrograding till sun comes to Cancer. After that, on a certain degree, Jupiter will start becoming direct. That's the way it is. Okay. So that's the way it seems to be. So at these points, if you see, it's a 5-9 relationship throughout, 5-7-9 relationship, and sun appears is at its farthest points possible from Jupiter. Similar is the case with Mars, and so is the case with Saturn. Okay. Now, but at these points, when they are retrograding, okay, they're closest to the Earth. Please pay total attention to this part when you're seeing this, because it will be over in a split second. So you can see that this is, can you see the retrograde effect over here? Can you see this retrograde effect? The planet is moving, but it is very close to the Earth over here. It's very close to the Earth over here. So any planet, so anything that is very close to Earth, or you know, any light which is very close to me, or any vibration which is very close to me, will affect me the strongest. So that is why the retrograde planet affects you very much. I hope the concept is clear now. That yes. You will see that both the planets are moving. They are not moving. They are not moving in a reverse direction. Nothing. No. In this universe, there's only one way, and that's way forward. So we all evolve for the good or the better of our worse, but we all evolve. But this retrograde is an effect that it gives on us, and it is a concentrated effect, if I can say so, on us. And people who are born during this phase are born with a concentrated effect of this. This planet will show its effect in the chart on a very, very strong basis. Again, as I said, that it is very far away from the sun. Now, sun in our astrology is also taken as the father. Okay? So, it is far away from the sun, and the planet is trying to assert itself. Understand that. The planet is trying to assert himself. He has to break that bracket. He has to come out of that bondage. So, there's always a kind of a dilemma. It's kind of a fight against a certain system. And this is just one of the points that I'm covering. Okay. There are many, many such points we will see. Because retrograde planets is a study in itself. Now, one more thing you have to understand is, no matter what it is written in the classics, some classics say that the retrogrades are not good. Some classics say retrogrades can do this, that, everything said and done. But the classics are very, very clear on one point. Classics are very clear that Vakrinastu Mahavirya. What do you mean by Vakrinastu Mahavirya? It means the retrograde planets are very, very strong. Be it a retrograde malefic. Jupiter is a retrograde, can be a malefic for a Libra Lagna person. And Venus can be a malefic for a Sagittarius Lagna person. But if these planets are malefic, then they can give malefic results. And a very strong Jupiter is one of the worst Marakas possible. If it becomes a Maraka, it is one of the worst Marakas possible.
Because it expands also.
Yeah, because it will kill you. It can kill you with cancer.
Yes.
So we cannot say that this retrograde is good or bad.
Yes, okay. That is very important, because whenever people hear it, the planet is strong, they think it is indicating the planet is very good, it will make me a millionaire or something like that. So don't think like that.
No, you can't think like that.
Yes.
And every planet, trust me, every planet, even an exalted planet, will show some of its effects which are not very good. Sri Ramchandra ji had how many exalted planets? He had 5 exalted planets and a Bhargottama moon sitting in its own house with forming Gaj Kesari yogas. Sri Ramchandra ji had Jupiter exalted, Saturn retrograde and exalted, Jupiter exalted in the Lagna in Cancer, Saturn retrograde and exalted in the 4th house, in the 7th house, Mars exalted. In the 9th house, Venus exalted, and along with Ketu. And in the 10th house, he had Sun exalted. Mercury was in the 11th house. So Sun was Digbali. Sun was so exalted. But then what happened? Because of the exalted 10th Lord in the 7th house, because of his dharma, he had to let go of his wife. So we think that exalted planets are very good and debilitated planets are very bad. There's no such thing like that. Debilitated bad planets will also give their effect. They will make you work more hard. Planets cannot be good and bad. It's very, very important for us to understand that. It is our karmas. They are just dispensing off with the karma. Okay, they don't have any personal agenda against us. So whatever we have got in our chart, they just deliver that. How we react creates further karma. So I'll just take an opportunity here, Babaji, to say this, because you know, you do a lot on Gita and everything. So you know this better than most. In the Gita also, he told Arjun in the second adhyay that he said that Arjun, if you do not fight, people will call you a coward. People who have looked upon you will do this, will defame you and all these things. And that will come to a point where you would want to commit suicide. In the 11th chapter, he tells Arjun that, Arjun, see, I have killed everybody. All you need to do is get up, do and put up an act. And even then in the 18th chapter, he tells Arjun that I'm giving you the freedom to choose what you want to do now. So no matter what we think, we are given that choice. We are given a freedom of how to act, not to react.
Yes, the freedom is there.
Yeah, free will is there. Free will is there. People don't realize that. People think
the problem is people think free will means to the extent we can change our existing karma. That's not free will. Free will means how we react to the destiny which we already have. No? That's
beautiful.
And that's why that free will is always there. It was there and it will always be there.
Exactly.
Take that us away from us.
Exactly. That's very beautifully put. You know, because you see, Arjun's free will could only operate in that battlefield. He could not say that, okay, if I have a free will, I will go back to my palace. He couldn't do that. He had to be in the battlefield. But how he reacted in that battlefield, whether he took up the fight or whether he left the fight.
Yes.
That was free will. Free will is not that he will go away and he says, God says, okay, I give you the permission to take a choice.
In this context, people would think that free will could mean that Arjuna evades the war altogether, which is not possible. So
which
now,
is not,
free will is either he fights or he doesn't. But the war is destined that will happen.
Yeah. See, if Arjuna wouldn't have killed them, somebody else would have killed them. Somebody else would have killed them.
Yes.
Because they were, according to Krishna in the 11th chapter, he had killed them. They were dead.
And so Arjuna, when Krishna reveals his Virat Roop, Arjuna sees, you know, Drona, Bhishma and Duryodhana, everybody is going to his mouth. So
Karna, Jayadrath, he says, Karna, Jayadrath, Drona, Bhishma, all of them are going in your mouth and you are just gulping their blood also. I can't understand. I'm getting petrified. Please tell me what is happening. So he tells them that this is happening. So I personally, when people say free will, no, your prarabdha is fixed. Free will means how you are going to work on that prarabdha. Are you going to react with your past tendencies, or are you going to sit down, think, and then create, help create a better prarabdha for tomorrow?
Because if you say that I can change my destiny, then that's not destiny then.
Yeah.
The Guru used to say, it's like self-contradictory. You say, can we change our destiny? But destiny means something which is already destined.
Destined.
How do you come to that question altogether, that can we change our destiny? That's a riddle. I mean, you can't ask that question. It's like...
it's a paradox.
Yes. The only thing we can do is use our current situation in a way that we can react to it in a proper way. That is all.
We can act to it in a proper way. Yes. Because if we react, the actions are always past based. Yes. So we act. We take a time out and we act. And I have been talking about this karma now because retrograde planets are the ones which have a relation to your past life. So in some life, you have had an opportunity to work against somebody, some of these things. As a result, in this lifetime, you are facing those situations. You are learning how to counter those situations, or you had decided in past life that yes, I did not complete my learning lessons against these kind of situations. I want to complete it to the full. For all those who are engineers and doctors and who sit for supplements, you know that if you don't pass an exam, you have to sit for a supplement. So the retrograde planet, you can take it extra work, supplement before you are graduated, before you can break off that planet. Okay. So I have scientifically told you how you can see that this no planet is retrograde, because this planet is, no planet moves in a backward direction because all planets move ahead. And I have also told you that this is the point when the distance between the Earth and this planet is the shortest. So the effect is the greatest. When we're talking on the level of karma, karma means that this is something that you have not done in past life, or a lesson not properly learned, and you have come back to learn that lesson. Planets from Mars outwards are retrograde. When they are in opposite side of the sun. This means that one attracts people who tend not to cooperate and who take advantage of such people. So lack of cooperation and advantage taken of might be karmic, and there is a need to pay special attention to it in the chart of this person. Okay. Now, we have three retrograde planets that we are talking about, because we are talking about Mars outwards. So we are going to talk about Mars, Jupiter and Saturn, not about Neptune, Pluto and Uranus, Neptune and Pluto, because we are sticking on to Vedic astrology. Okay. Now, retrograde Mars could account for a fight within the self for establishing ways to express the strong inherent energy and sometimes sexuality. Especially in case of females, we've seen that. Okay. So they could be feminists. A lot of things. I'll take up the chart here of Louis May Alcott. She was a phenomenal writer. Okay. And she was born to parents who wanted to show a different side. She was born to parents who were reformist teachers in those times, and her father, because he was always experimenting with education and everything. So in 30 years, they changed 22 houses. See, in today's day and time, it's very easy to change houses, okay? Relatively very, very easy. In those days, when you're moving not just from one, in the neighborhood, you're moving from one city to another with the entire baggage and entourage. It was not an easy task. And now we will see Mars retrograde here. How do you know what you are opposing or what is influencing you? Mars is the lord of the fourth house. It is the lord of the ninth house. And it is situated in the tenth house. Now, when we are talking about the time, it's 1832 that she was born in. Her novel came out in 1868. Okay, so nearly 36 years of age. That was quite a ripe age. Even in those days, it was extremely ripe age for a lady. And we're talking about the 18s, not even the 19s. During those times, for ladies to be authors was extremely difficult a task. And to come out as, she also used a pen name. Now let us connect the houses. It's the fourth house. Fourth house is of mother. Fourth house is of security. Fourth house is of home. Fourth house is education. Ninth house of father, of recognition, of traditional studies, and 10th house of service, of job, of again, higher recognition in your work and things like that. Okay? Ninth house is also legality of marriage. Now, as I said, that Mars in women sometimes can also have a issue with sexuality. So, if you read Wikipedia, it's written in Wikipedia also that I'll come to that point later. But first, Louis May's mother, Abigail, had to make, because her father was very eccentric kinds where he wanted to start new schools and reformist ideas and things like that. And he was forever traveling and they didn't have a lot of money, as a result of which the mother had to work a lot. So her mother, Abigail, resented her husband's inability to recognize his sacrifices and related his thoughtlessness to the larger issue of inequality of sexes. She passed this recognition and desire to redress wrong done to women onto Louis, male court. Okay? As a result, you see, she was a feminist. She was a feminist and she was forever fighting for a female's right. So you can see the effect of retrograde planet, and moreover, this retrograde, this fourth lord is aspecting the fourth house. Can you see that effect? Now, if you see the degree of that planet, okay, in Taurus, Mars, you will see it's 3 degrees. And the sun also has to, it's bang opposite the sun, 7 houses. By the time sun reaches the 9th house from Mars, it will definitely have moved on to the 9th to Aries. Okay? That means it is affecting Aries also, the 9th house, of which it is the ruler. Okay? Are you getting my point, Bhaji?
Yes.
So now, father. She got a lot of reformistic ideas from her father. You know, at the end of his life, near the end of his life, her father wrote a poem for her. A selfless daughter, selfless, faithful daughter to my Louis. So because she always looked after her father. And she came up as a very well-read lady, but she was very wild because of so much of travel, broken education. She came up as a very wild child, you know. So, her father had a lot of problems with her initially. But then at the end, when she was taking care of her father and the house, he was very, very happy. He was grateful to her and he had written a poem to her, which she has published in one of her autobiographies. Now, let's take up the 10th house. Poverty made it necessary for Alcott to go to work at an early age as a teacher, seamstress, governess, domestic helper, and writer. And it was the writing. See, Mars also represents ink. So it was writing. It's there on Wikipedia that it was the writing that gave her relief. So retrograde planet will show which areas you're going to reflect. See, because it's also the fourth lord of Mars's, this lady attitude of being a feminist ingrained from her mother, seen in the behavior of her father, reflects in her work also. If you read the book Little Women, which is very, very famous, at least in my childhood, I had read that, and it was a masterpiece. It is a masterpiece. It is a classic. So you can see how this energy is operating. And now I come to that point where I was talking that Mars energy can have an effect on the sexuality also. She says, it's categorically stated, I take it from Wikipedia, where she says that there are many pretty women that I have fallen in love with and never ever a single man. So you can see where she gets that from, that energy from. Okay, now, so do you have any questions before I move on to Jupiter?
Very good. Okay.
Thank you. So when we are moving on to Jupiter, retrograde Jupiter gives a person a strong out-of-box thinking and approaching things and finding success where others have failed. This is something I've seen very common across, you know, people with retrograde Jupiter, that they have an out-of-box thinking. Nowadays, in the elder generation, we find something called Alzheimer's, a very, very common disease coming up. But do you know who found out about it? It was Alois Alzheimer. He was a German psychiatrist and a neuropathist, pathologist, and he was a colleague of Emil Carpe. You know, he was the one, dementia, perennial dementia was something that was mentioned throughout, but he was the one to find out about it. And later on, because he was the one to find out about it, they gave it a name in his honor, named it Alzheimer's. Okay, now we need to understand a few things about him. He was fifth house. Okay, Jupiter is the seventh lord and the tenth lord. Seventh lord relates to wife, partnership, your profession. That is also the place of Pad Prapti. And tenth house is also again the place of Pad Prapti. Fifth house is government services. Fifth house is your knowledge, is your intelligence. Jupiter in fifth house, Jupiter is the Karaka of fifth house. It is also children because it is the Karaka of fifth house. Fifth house is, as I said, government also. Now, Pada Prapti, these two houses. How many scientists have got diseases named after them? They don't have many. When Alois was working in a hospital there, he had a lot of tuffle with the forces, a lot of tuffle with the government institutions and everybody, Lord, because he was very, very dedicated. He was very focused about what he wanted to do. And there he met, and it was a time when paperwork and red tapism was at its best. So he had to undergo a lot of it. And there was this one patient of his who was suffering from dementia, as per him. And her husband wanted to take her and put her in a different psychiatric ward or hospital, but he did not allow her to go. So he was also showing his power, you know, that the seventh lord or the tenth house of power and position working for him. So he was fighting with authorities. At the same time, he was being authoritative on others. And Jupiter is, as it is, a Vaidya. Do you know? You know that, right? Jupiter is a Vaidya. So you see, it's a physician by profession. How it works when you opposition with these planets are seen. And you, if you see the chart here, the opposition is going to end soon. Why? Why is the opposition going to end soon? Because the sun has come in the ninth house to Jupiter. Okay. And if I go by the degrees also, the slowly it will take nearly one month for Jupiter to go direct, because it would be actually must have been retrograde for 4 months, and now after a month or 15, 20 days, it will go direct. So it was very late in his life that he got recognition of something called presenile dementia, which was later named as Alzheimer's. Okay, and then who was he opposing, or who was he fighting? He was fighting against the sun, representing the government forces. And he was being extremely dominating. That was also something that he was fighting. People were fighting or opposing him. That lady's husband was opposing him through and through. And she later on died in his custody. Now, I come to the last one. We are talking about retrograde Saturn. Retrograde Saturn gives a person a lack of self-worth, or a self-doubting nature, or an introvert personality. Also conflict with authority. Okay, so now, how, why? Because you see, why conflict with authority, or why a self-doubting personality? If you look at the status of Saturn in the Vedic astrology, it's very far away from the sun. Okay, and it's supposed to be a very cold and a damp planet. Okay, so as it is, it's not getting heat and light. So there is not much vibrancy in there. Moreover, it gets retrograde. So it becomes a more introverted personality. And wherever a person is introvert, it is often seen that the person can suffer from self-doubt, or may not be in love with their own self. You know, you will see people who have retrograde Saturn, because Sun is authority, they will always have problems with that authority. You know, somewhere down the line, they will always have problems with their authority. Now, with these people, now let us talk about Saturn here. Saturn is sitting in the fourth house. Okay, and we're talking about Ernest Miller Hemingway. He is also a Nobel Prize winner. He was an exceptional journalist, and he was fearless, as it can be seen. World War II, Spanish War, French War, you name it, he's been there in person to cover. Okay. Sports person, you name the sports, he's been a part of the sports. Sorry, but I have a cold. Okay. So, weather's changing in India, and I had this, just contracted it today. So, this gentleman, you see, is Saturn. Where is Saturn sitting? Saturn is sitting in the fourth house. Okay, and Saturn is the lord of the sixth house and the seventh house. Fourth house is what? Mother. It is written in Wikipedia. Please go and read that. He professed to hate his mother as an adult. He had differences with his mother. But his autobiographer says that her enthusiasm, her free spirit is something that he imbibed. Subconsciously, we are all a reflection of our parents. And he imbibed that from his mother, his enthusiasm, his free spiritness, his ability to go anywhere and everywhere to cover events. His mother was a musician and she singer, and she went from village to village to sing and for her profession. So he's done that. She went from village to village, he went from country to country for his profession. Now, this Saturn is also the lord of the sixth house of war, strife, sahapatni, that is extramarital affairs. And you see, this is something he has been fighting against. He would cover wars and everything. And he was a person of few words. He had coined an ideology that is known as the iceberg ideology. Do you know an iceberg is, we can only see the tip of the iceberg. The iceberg is huge, huge below the water, but we only see the tip of the iceberg. So what he had a very crisp style of writing. And he like very economical. He used to write very little, but he used to cover a lot in that. So his ideology was known as iceberg ideology of putting up facts. he had moved over various zones, okay, war zones and everything. And there he kept meeting a lot of people and a lot of girls, ladies, and he had four wives, even in that day and age. Because you see, Saturn is also the lord of the seventh house. So there is a tussle. There's a fight in him. Whom to? What he wants. He himself was not aware of what he wanted. Or probably his wants and whims and fantasies changed over every period of time. Lastly, I'd just like to add that, see, Saturn aspects the sixth house. The sixth house is also the house of Akal Mrityu. That means sudden death. Sixth house is also the house of diseases. It's also the house of accidents. It is also the house of your Prarabdha. And Saturn, the sixth lord, retrograde. Again, this lord, sixth lord aspecting, it's a retrograde planet. It's very strong. It's aspecting the sixth house, its own house. So it doesn't mean it will not give the effects there. It gave him the effects of making him one of the most popular journalists across the world. Sixth house, he met with an accident somewhere. He was bedridden and he was in so much pain that finally he takes his own life. He commits suicide. So this is how retrograde planets will play out. And as I said, Saturn is a retrograde planet, so we think that it will not give good things. It gave him recognition, it gave him a lot of things. But with that, it also gave him that Akal Mrityu once again. So this is how I would, there's a lot more to retrograde planets that takes time, and where the retrograde planet is placed, which house it is, the lord of, all these things can be dealt in detail. But for now, this is what I have to speak on at the moment.
And do you have any slides for like Mercury, Venus?
No, Mercury, Venus, as I told you on the onset, we are dealing with struggle and strife. Okay. Where they will be struggling and striving.
Okay, so many people may.
So probably for next time I'll come up with Mercury and Venus.
Yeah, like what I wanted to know was, like, somebody may ask that, do you think they also behave in a similar way, or like, what do you think?
No, they will not behave in a similar way. Mm-hmm. They have their own issues. Mercury will have its own issues with Sun, and so will Venus. But it is not about struggle and strife. It is not about this struggle and strife.
Okay. Generally, they say Venus is retrograde, like some issues in married life, or Mercury is retrograde.
Yeah, it will. It is. See, Mars and Venus will have sexuality issues because they're associated with the second, eighth, first, and seventh houses. And moreover, Venus is a wife in a lady in a man's chart, and Mars is wife in a female's. Venus is wife in a man's chart and Mars is husband in a female's chart. So obviously there will be issues regarding that. But there are very many other issues except for just these issues of husband and wife or problems in marital life. They will be very, like Venus retrograde can be very critical. Mercury retrograde will think five times before it talks. So there is a lot of things associated with these two, apart from, we will do it some other time. We'll pick it up some other time.
Okay, sure. And if somebody is wondering, what about Sun and Moon? So just for information, they are never retrograde, and Rahu Ketu are almost retrograde all the time.
Yes. So that is why we never take up these planets for retrograde. And we don't count Uranus, Neptune and Pluto in Vedic astrology. So we don't take up. These planets are also retrograde. If you have a software in your where you want to see Neptune, Uranus and Pluto, it does show whether it's
retrograde. You can get it on astrosage.com. You can get it for free, or in Drig Panchang also you can get. And in Drig Panchang,
you can also get it in. You can also get it in Jehora. Jehora also shows.
Okay.
You have to put the setting like that.
Okay. Amazing. Thank you so much. I am very sure this will be very informative for people who have at least a retrograde Mars, Jupiter, or Saturn, because Jupiter and Saturn, they stay retrograde for so long.
Jupiter, Saturn stays retrograde for 5 months, nearly.
So almost, you know, like 30-40% of the people have these two retrograde, and Mars also for long time almost. Okay, thank you so much. And just as a reminder, if somebody has not seen her channel, then please go and subscribe to her channel. And you also do consultation, so I will give the link of her website down in the description. So if you want a consultation regarding retrograde planets, then you can go and book a reading with her. Okay, anything else you would like to say?
I like to say that retrograde planets are beautiful. Don't be fear of them. See what they have to say and work on them, because then you will be working out your past life karmas. And when you start working out on your past life karmas, life becomes much more smooth, much more easy.
So use your free will properly and don't try to compete with that destiny. Whatever is happening, let it happen. Don't resist it, and just act in a proper way.
Go with the flow.
Okay. Thank you so much. See you again, madam.
Thank you.